Africa's agricultural sector faces up to COVID-19. South Africa and Kenya are the two largest sub-Saharan consumers of cheese and are part of the global market estimated at $70 billion in 2019. South African cheese consultant Kobus Mulder has organized annual cheese festivals and workshops in Rwanda, Tanzania, and elsewhere on the continent. A cow is a wonderful thing, he says. You can milk it on Wednesday, and by Friday, you've got food and money. If you plant beans, you wait months. If you plant grapes or pears, you wait 6 or 7 years. But if you give a person a cow, you double his money almost immediately, he says. Rwanda's national cattle herd was 1.3 million in 2019, according to a report from the Dutch government. Agricultural products account for 63% of export earnings, and the contribution of milk to national GDP is projected to be $173 million by 2022. As the Rwandan government seeks to move beyond subsistence farming towards a business-oriented modern dairy sector. About 20% of the Rwandan population is considered to be food insecure, and 38% live below the poverty line. The Rwandan population is growing at 2.3% per year, and demand for milk is growing along with the population. Yet, consumption of other dairy products is rare and cheese is considered a luxury. Mulder says that Africa produces roughly 145,000 tons of cheese annually, with production growing at 6% per year. The growth of the African cheese industry can improve nutrition and protein intake and help lift more farming families out of poverty. But its success depends on creating a demand for cheese. The continent's cheese makers need greater discipline to resist demands to sell immature cheese to buyers, which risk damaging its reputation, says Mulder. Instead, a widening culinary culture, growing recognition of outstanding African chefs, and upmarket hotels will drive demand for artisan cheeses. There is about 25 cheese makers in Rwanda. Local consumption is slowly growing, and the government is behind cheese quality, he says. It's a sign of confidence that banks are giving loans to buy new equipment, and if a government is behind cheese making and doesn't meddle, but assists the cheese making industry, it can produce cheese and good cheese. Raymond Seibert, manager of South Africa's Glen River Cheese Company, says that cheese consumption will increase in tandem with yogurt, cream, and milk consumption. When you see consumers start to explore more dairy products and put it on their weekly menus at home, then the market will mature. For artisan cheese in Africa, we need a city with 100 top-end restaurants and hotels to create that critical mass to grow demand. In Kigali, Innocent Karuranga, founder of Kavabon Cheese Company, as a way of preserving nutrients in milk. He specializes in making delicate blue cheese and camemberts. The market in Rwanda is there. As more people adopt the dietary habits of European people, says Karuranga. His first cheesery was destroyed in 1994, and he went on to work in humanitarian missions with the Red Cross. But he is now negotiating a partnership with a group of European investors who have relocated to Rwanda. There you have it, guys. Hope this business news update was resourceful. Join the family by clicking on the red subscribe button below and also turn on the notification bell so that you get notified each time we upload a new video. And don't forget to drop us a comment to let us know which topics you want us to cover in the nearest future or in our subsequent videos. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye bye.
Africa's private equity industry in serious stress. Africa's private equity industry has been partly shielded by the impact of COVID-19 due to the continent's relative lack of cases, the dominance of development finance institutions, and its prior exposure to crisis. But partners fear that the pandemic impacts on exits, according to a report. The COVID-19 response report by the Oxford Business Group and the African Private Equity and Venture Capital Association found that the Africa-focused industry raised $1.1 billion in funds and arranged 81 private equity deals totaling $700 million in the first half of the year, with financials, IT, and consumer discretionary accounting for 49% of deals by volume. The pandemic sparked renewed interest in education and healthcare. The latter accounted for the largest share of deals by value at 24%. The AVCA says that the prominent role of development finance institutions, DFIs, in Africa's private equity industry offered resilience, with some DFIs introducing strategies to shield their investments from the pandemic and most investments already armed with strict environmental, social, and governance criteria. Other DFIs have pooled their expertise into working groups to respond to the crisis. Furthermore, the AVCA says that African fund managers were better able to provide support and enable continuity at portfolio companies, having already dealt with challenges in Africa, including shorter supply chains, more debts, and less inventory. This built-in preparedness ensured that many portfolio companies were able to absorb some of the initial shocks in global supply chain and local demand, says the report. Nevertheless, the pandemic has exposed some of the African private equity industry's inherent weaknesses. Weak exit environments, political risk, and currency fluctuations have all been exacerbated by the pandemic, and African governments are unlikely to offer financial assistance to distressed companies. The uncertainty has led fund managers in sub-Sahara Africa to close their funds at smaller sizes during the pandemic, with some anticipating a reduction in capital inflows, particularly from European commercial investors and Asian institutional investors. An AVCA survey in April found that 49% of respondents expected a 6 to 12 months delay in capital deployment. Over 90% of respondents listed the financial impact of the pandemic as their top concern, with over half concerned by a potential global recession and around 45% fearing a dip in consumer confidence that has impacted confidence around exits, with 57% saying that exit opportunities were the greatest challenge in Africa in the small or medium term. 13 exits were recorded in the first half of 2020 compared to 25 in the first half of 2019 and 45 for the year. Exits are further complicated by travel restrictions, which are impeding the ability of investors to carry out due diligence, says AVCA. Nevertheless, several high-profile exits have been concluded this year, including the $288 million acquisition of payment company DPO Group by Dubai-based Network International in July and the $500 million acquisition of remittances firm Sendwave by World Remit in August, suggesting that investors retain faith in the longer-term potential of compelling Africa-focused companies.